Welcome to The Keypoint, presented by Keypoint Intelligence. We help you cut through the noise of data, offering unbiased insights in printing technology and communications.
At Keypoint Intelligence, we transform data into analysis, testing into tools, and insights into strategy. We provide strategic planning resources, including market research, competitive intelligence, testing, sales training, go-to-market support, and customer engagement to supplier and service providers.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Welcome again to another episode of the Keypoint Podcast. I'm your host today, Carl Schell, and with me, as always, Ann Valaitis, my good buddy and podcasting mate. How are we doing today?
Excellent. Thank you, Carl. That's an amazing introduction, and I'm happy to be here.
Well, I'm looking forward to talking to you more about AI as we've been doing over the last year or so now. But before we do that, I have a very important question to run by you. Take your temperature on this one, Anne. Now that we've passed Labor Day, is summer officially over, or will summer not end until the official calendar date of September 22nd? Your answer would be?
Personally, I hold on to summer with both hands, feet, hugging it as long as possible.
So we're going with September 22nd, and you want to know something? I agree with you, but I'm going to go in completely the different way because summer is my least favorite season. So I'd like summer to be over already, but I don't believe it's over until September 22nd. So we win.
We win. Great.
Let's start talking about AI, shall we? Thought it would be fun to kind of just introduce some AI news, and we haven't done this in a few months, so a lot has changed, obviously. And I happened to be on vacation, basketball tournaments in July, and I woke up one day and I saw that that Wall Street was kind of cooling on AI, and stock prices were kind of falling a little bit, shall we say? Certainly not a good look for the technology, artificial intelligence, but I don't think that really tells the full story. So what do you have to say to that?
Honestly, I think that it's a positive development. And here's why I think it's a positive development. Typically, this does indicate that we're starting a new life cycle, right? We're kind of moving past the hype cycle.
Sure.
Of everybody talking about it, right? Lots of tools, lots of developments. It's not to say that their development has slowed, but what I hope to be seeing is that that companies that are really starting to figure out their AI strategies, right? And the cooling off period, according to Wall Street, is a natural process that we see, and companies then move forward, right, with more plans. So I honestly feel that it is the cycle of what we should be seeing, right? Mm-hmm. We're moving into more of a tech life cycle. It's very common to see this sort of thing. And as more companies, you know, kind of spend this year deciding what they want to do with AI, we'll then start seeing some real implementation moving forward. Plus, all of the new news that we see from all of the platform providers and typical software providers that are adding AI in, right? That's just going to drive, you know, what we see into this life cycle even further. So I'm very optimistic about it.
As am I. And that was a great answer. You know, we've seen slow adoption on things in the past, you know, there's something, it's big, everyone knows about it, not everyone is using it. And then maybe there's actually this cooling off period or multiple cooling off periods. You've been in the industry for a long time. What's the one thing that you could kind of equate it to in terms of a tech life cycle?
Well, it really is sort of like the pattern of cloud adoption, right? We saw this over the last years, right? There was the hype, the excitement over what the cloud could do, right? Then there was the period of kind of testing, policy creation, right?
Sure.
Organizations were really trying to understand what this meant for them, what the safety, right, secure regulations to make sure that they were kind of meeting all of that, the vendors, customers as well, trying to understand how this will affect all of that. And it, you know, so that same pattern that we saw with cloud adoption, it was slow, but now it's ubiquitous. So I think we'll see the same sort of thing. Funny that we're talking about this today, because I recently heard a vendor in the IT department really talk about how they see AI so differently than other tech adoption within their own company, right? Things like CRMs, right? And the promise of what a CRM can do for an organization. And I'm not saying it didn't deliver on many of the promises that it did, but from an IT perspective, it took so long, right? It took so much time to do. It added, I don't know, tens more keystrokes to what people were doing, right? Even before that. So yep. Like, this is so great. They look very often now at AI as completely different, and that the promise of the technology that AI brings will really be different than a kind of traditional other integrations that they've seen before. So that was just something that I heard really recently that I think is a good way to think about it and how IT is really kind of looking at it.
Yeah. So let's go back to that cloud example for a second, because, you know, even 5 years ago, 6 years ago, before the pandemic, cloud adoption was slow. And I want to say a lot of it is due to cost, of course. You know, we have these kind of things that are working. They're not breaking. They're fine. Over time, they do break down, and then we replace them with cloud technology in a lot of cases. So my question then is mainly about like the AI adoption, right? Companies like us have to experiment on their own, but maybe as we continue to armor up here, if you will, in the AI front, you'll see people developing with AI and selling those professional services to companies that might be laggards, might be involved, but want to kind of move it to a steroid level of AI in their organization, et cetera. Your thoughts on that would be?
Yeah, I mean, I think that what you're describing is kind of the explorers and the innovators, right? And different companies. I was giving this example recently too, that I've worked for many companies over the years that took a very conservative, kind of cautious approach to a lot of different technologies, not kind of wanting to go over the hill first, right? Let another go over the hill, like let the innovators go first.
Sure.
Take this kind of wait and see approach, want to make sure that, you know, all of the kind of, you know, bumps that might, you know, come about, let the innovators kind of deal with that, right? And learn from it, right? And a lot of companies
totally
do that, right? So they'll learn from it, whether it's competitors or other organizations like them, right? But, you know, I think that with AI, the promise is real, and it is a lot different than some of the other things that we've seen before. You know, if you look at just generative AI and the ability for you and I to use it free, right?
Mm-hmm.
We do have a corporate version. We talk about it in other podcasts, and we'll probably talk about it again today. But we made that leap, right, as an innovator. But I've worked in places where, you know, you're trying out the free version for a while, and then you want to make sure that it isn't just hype, right? That the promise is real. We're seeing this kind of over and over again with generative AI. It's really doing what it says it's going to do. It's helping create content, right? It's helping summarize documents. It's helping you really kind of streamline your tasks in a different way. And that's just independently, right? Individually for our jobs. When you apply that thinking to kind of departmental use or even full organization-wide use, really kind of uplifting everybody. I think you said steroid use. That's a really great way to think about it. Everything's kind of getting an uplift. And the more we see this and the more adoption, everybody's going to be feeling this. So I think that, you know, we're really kind of moving into this advancement phase where even cautious organizations who don't want to be over the hill, right, don't really consider themselves an innovator, maybe a bit of a lagger, even they're kind of being pushed forward with all the promise that's going on.
Let's talk about AI as it pertains to Keypoint Intelligence. Mm. I know that you did a webinar in Japan in early August, And I know it was quite successful from a numbers standpoint, but just give the listeners a heads up about what you guys were talking about, what you introduced, maybe a key moment or two.
Yeah, we had a webinar in early August, and it was initially to our Japanese audience, but it really ended up being kind of representative of that region of APAC. And we had about 13 countries represented, which was nice. Really great throughout Asia. We had a really large audience. So it, very often with a webinar, in a live webinar, you're not really sure, given time differences and how, you know, people can kind of attend. A lot of people sometimes register and then listen to recording afterwards. But we had a really great kind of large live audience with those countries I said represented it. The engagement and the interest levels kind of throughout the whole presentation was really encouraging. We had myself, Lisa Brown, who's also a principal analyst with the AI group within it. And then we had West McDonald, and West is part of GoWest.ai, if you're not familiar. And he's a partner of ours, and he works with us within our AI services that we offer here. So part of it was kind of talking about our services, but the majority of it was really on trends and insights and kind of what we're discovering. So it was really great to be able to kind of impart some thought leadership to them. And I think that they really appreciated kind of what we presented. We had a great session on regulation, and we kind of cover globally what's going on with AI regulation. It's moving pretty fast. So we looked at China, we looked at Japan, we looked at the EU, which is kind of the granddaddy of what we see in terms of AI regulations right now. And the timing was just like, I couldn't have perfected this. The day we did the presentation, the EU Act was in effect.
So just well, we knew that ahead of time,
August
didn't we?
1st. I really didn't even plan it. It just happened to be that way. So they were really interested in understanding those implications of AI regulations for developers and partnerships and things that they're doing. So we saw a really good, strong desire from them to really understand, you know, kind of not just the regulation, but kind of the ethical things as well, right? Mm. And we talked about tools. There's all sorts of ground that we covered. It was almost 2 hours long. It was great.
Nice. And the engagement during Q&A was very good.
Fantastic. We had a lot of follow-up. So we're excited to be doing even more with that team out of Japan and with these Asia-Pac vendors. And they weren't just office equipment vendors. We had production print, right? We had software vendors. We had a lot of different types of companies that were part of it. So just goes to show you how interesting, right, AI is as a topic, and covering it was really important for us to do as well.
Nice. Before we continue, I just want to say that West of GoWest.ai and our very own Randy Dazzo now have a twice a month live stream on LinkedIn. So you can check that out. Just find us and there'll be plenty of marketing up there and posts and ultimately theaters to enter where you can watch the sessions. I think they're on Thursdays, if I'm not mistaken.
I think they are too. And I was on the first one. It was great. And they kind of went through kind of what the whole series will be like all the way up until December. So really good content. They have guests on, right? They're covering all sorts of tools and topics. They're talking to dealers, right, about their experiences. There's just going to be a lot of great information out of that.
Nice. So we did one webinar in APAC. Is there a webinar planned for North America, US?
Yeah, we're actually planning to do sort of the same version of what we did in APAC here in the US. Coming up in a couple of weeks. We're taking a little bit of a different approach in that we're kind of cutting it down a little bit. We had a lot of content for Japan, mostly because there was a lot of ground to cover and we really hadn't talked to them. So we're just kind of shortening it up a little bit for this time around. We will have Lisa Brown back again with us, West from Go West. As you just mentioned, he'll be back again. He's really available to provide all these great insights from the many readiness assessments he's done. So Lisa and I have great content from the advisory service, right, from the benchmarking study that we've done and the conversations and things that we're working on from an analysis standpoint. And then West is doing really kind of guerrilla, right, on the ground readiness assessments with organizations, not just dealerships, but vendors, you know, in this space as well and not in this space as well. Mm-hmm. So he's got great, great, valuable insights to share that we can't wait to kind of talk about again. It's going to be similar. Like I said, the content will be similar, but we're really going to explore how AI is impacting the U.S. market, right?
Nice.
It is awesome. U.S. and Western Europe, but we want to make sure that we're going to discuss the relevant regulations that have to do with this region, right? And share some of those strategies.
That's awesome. You mentioned Lisa a couple of times. Lovely, lovely person. And I know she just published a blog on healthcare and AI. So this is research that you guys were recently doing. I'm going to take a couple minutes to discuss this.
Yeah, the benchmarking study that I mentioned, we conducted a few months ago. So we're taking a few vertical splits from that data and we're creating analysis documents. And she wrote a blog about the recent analysis document that we presented on healthcare. You know, AI in healthcare is such an interesting thing. There's so many different ways that AI is being affected in healthcare, right? Whether it's patients or diagnostics, right?
Compliance,
right? There's so many different areas within healthcare that AI can, right, affect and where they're looking to kind of move forward to do these sorts of things. We hear always this ability to kind of have AI look at films, right, or different diagnostic things and make really fast diagnostics with, of course, the help of the healthcare provider kind of validating and verifying. I mean, that's so, you know, we're talking about kind of the good and bad of it, but, you know, the ability to kind of summarize and bring together information so quickly is really helpful. And every day I hear different ways that people are kind of looking at understanding within healthcare how AI can help them. So look for that analysis document. It's in the service now. If you have any questions about it, you know, feel free to reach out. We'd love to talk to anybody about it.
That's awesome. And for the general public, you guys can just read that blog on our blog page on keypointintelligence.com. It was published relatively recently, so it's pretty quick to find. Speaking of Keypoint Intelligence, the company we both work for, and we continue to tool around, experiment, and make good discoveries on the AI front, whether it's with content or processes or research or whatever. You know, one that I've been hearing about and that I'm seeing is just summarizing of meetings and making it easier to distill information, regardless if it's, I've heard that from salespeople, I've heard that from SMEs. It doesn't really make a difference, but that's definitely a huge one that I've been hearing a lot of. You hit on content creation, obviously a very high level use of AI, particularly chat, and all the other platforms out there. What are you seeing? What are you doing?
Yeah, I mean, I do both of those. So very regularly, pretty much every day. And I would say just to go further into the meeting summaries, it's interesting what we see is when in the past, when you haven't kind of recorded and had an AI summary or even a transcript of a meeting that's been conducted, very often the tasks at the end that are provided out, right? Carl, I need you to do X, Y, and Z. Anne's going to do A, B, and C. What we found is that sometimes those aren't always captured correctly in the past. So it's perception. So you did not necessarily think that you were doing X, Y, and Z. You thought maybe you were just doing X. So it's so fascinating to see kind of a transcript and a summary that you can go back to very easily that says, no, in fact, you agreed to X, Y, and Z. Maybe that's not the best example. I'm not saying you specifically, but to be clear, when we take notes in any meeting, and I think anybody would agree to this, is you're very often kind of suspending listening, at least for a moment, right, to take your notes, or you're only involved in the notes that, you know, you're, trying to record at the moment, as opposed to what the words actually say. And there's been enough data that suggests that that's been a problem kind of consistently. So it is so useful and helpful to have transcript and then an AI recap that really goes through what specific tasks people are committed to or what they've been assigned, and just to have it there and saying, okay, you know, I either didn't remember it correctly or I didn't take the note down correctly. So to have that, I can't say that enough about it. I use it every single day, every meeting that we have. Yep. When it's agreed to, if we can record it and summarize it, and the AI part of it really helps. The other thing is I'm an analyst, so I'm forever researching. I'm forever looking at websites, and I'm out on the web looking at desk research or looking at different announcements or you name it in terms of news. Not just with AI, but AI adjacent. So the ability to do that faster, kind of streamline that data collection, and then the summarization of that data has really been really, really helpful. And then when you marry that with data that we have internally, we do a lot of research here internally, right? There's a lot of interviews that we do. There's a lot of survey data that we have to go through. So the ability to kind of quickly summarize and look at very specific data points has been just very, very helpful from an analysis point of view.
That's awesome. Yeah, I'll add a few notes here. And the first thing is about those notes and taking notes. And it's funny you bring that up because, you know, I interview dealers a lot of the time, dealer principals a lot of the time. And, you know, dealer principals sometimes just go on, can talk for a while, block paragraph after block paragraph. And, you know, it's during those times where I might have to take notes during their speech or whatever, their answer. But a lot of times I like to just wait until they're over and just say, hey, give me 30 seconds here. I just need to take a couple notes, blah, blah, blah. And then we kind of move on from there. So very interesting. And of course, a good use of AI to be able to just, you know, transcribe, summarize, et cetera. So that's one. I would say that with me over the last couple months, there have been two use cases of AI, which is really interesting. One, I can't give away too much because it's still in very much implementation mode, but it is interesting to see, you know, we changed the style of this particular deliverable to make it easier for AI to generate, to basically increase our efficiency with this particular process, maybe save a couple bucks too. So there's that. I was also presented with a custom GPT, which is basically like an SEO thing where you can flow a blog in there and feed it keywords and everything. And it was a really interesting thing that my lead editor here, Mark DiMattei, and I discussed a week or so ago. There's still some little kinks to work out, you know, and at some level it does still feel very robotic in the writing with what it does, but it is what it is. And it's an interesting, you know, find for me. It just kind of came to me. Greg in our production department put it together. We're still testing it, and we're probably going to have to customize the GPT a little bit more. But this is the kind of collaboration that I frankly enjoy. You know, a lot of the time, these other people are way smarter than I am, and they're actually doing the work and figuring it out, and super appreciative, because when I see it, I'm like pretty blown away, you know, always finding some little things to clean up or, you know, what have you. But that's just further discussion and collaboration. So I'd say it's a very unifying tool in some ways. I'm enjoying this first year with AI.
Yeah, I think if you just think about tasks that you're doing every day and how you can amp them up, right, by testing and using the tools that we have access to, you'll find it very helpful. You mentioned SEO, right? The ability to have content or documents better available for search. I use ChatGPT to help me even with keywords, right? I will have it look through a document that I have, whether it's a blog or something that I've written, and say, you know, give me 5 good keywords from this. Mm-hmm. Very 10 seconds. It takes no time at all. Where in some cases I would kind of labor over the words, or I would, you know, be delivering words that I, you know, the digital transformation, AI, implementation. I, you know, usually the first 2 or 3 make sense. And then you're struggling maybe with the 4th or the 5th. So use the tools at your disposal, right? Really make use of them. And honestly, when you use them enough, in some cases, then you don't need to use them, you know, day 5 or 6, because it's providing you with like an exercise of how your mind, right, it can be helpful to your mind. So I found that it can even help when I'm not using it, right? So it just reminds me of kind of a process and what to go through. So yeah, I think your example is really great. And I think those are just some of the things. And I encourage everybody to, you know, think about your workflow process, things that you would maybe go to Google for before, or you would go and you know, kind of labor with. Give it a try, you know, start small, little pilot projects, just try certain things. Obviously, make sure if you don't have some sort of AI use policy yet, make sure that you have one, or talk to leadership in your organization to make sure that you're using it the way it's supposed to be used and you're not kind of giving away any privacy or security or compliance issues. But once you're past that, I say, try it, give it a shot, right? Be using it every day and see what you can come from it. And after you do that, you'll find that every day you'll find something else to use it for.
There you go. No truer words there, Anne. Well, I think we've come to the end of our seventh podcast, which is unbelievable to think of. Lucky we've been doing seven. These quarterly almost for 2 years now. Feels great, and I want to keep doing it. So I can't wait to quarter four 2024 podcast with Anne Valaitis. Couple just housekeeping notes. You can find a lot of our information about advisory services, assessments, et cetera, on keypointintelligence.com, which is also the home of the Keypoint blog. Suggest you check that out. I would also say that you can check out the podcast page, which has more and more podcasts about artificial intelligence, including one that we posted last week on Wednesday about AI use cases with Keith and Lee. Great job they did. And the content just keeps flowing and AI keeps moving forward. So there's plenty to talk about. And Anne, I could not want to talk about it with anyone else aside from you.
Oh, thanks. I feel the same way. Always good to chat. Always so much to talk about. We never have too little to talk about. So
very true. Very true. And with that, I bid you adieu.
Thank you for listening to another edition of The Keypoint.
Listen to all of our episodes on your favorite podcast channel or on our website at keypointintelligence.com. Just click on the Resources tab to view podcasts in the drop-down menu.